Apologies for this. So I will talk about thermal convection, but it is also connected with the stably stratified flows. So we'll take buoyancy-driven flows as a theme because they are connected versions. So I'll basically focus on what is the spectrum for thermal convection. Is it Kolmogorov or non-Kolmogorov? Okay, so this is, everybody knows about this equation, but we need to just focus on Kolmogorov theory. Since it's a very broad conference, so I thought I will put this slide. So for fluid, incompressible fluids, we have a spectrum which is Kolmogorov, K minus 5/3, and constant flux. The flux is constant throughout, but this could change with buoyancy, because buoyancy works at all scales. Here we assume that forcing is at large scale, but in buoyancy we have forcing at all scales, thermal forcing. So that's the key, and we need to address that issue as we go along. So the two systems which we will study in this talk is RBC relevant, when heating is at the bottom and cooling at the top, and stably stratified flows, which is reversed, like Earth atmosphere, dense fluid at the bottom or cold plate at the bottom and hot at the top. Now, so this is the equation which we will deal with, is a Bushnell's fluid. So we have buoyancy term, which is here. Theta is the temperature difference from the conduction temperature. So it's a fluctuation over the conducting profile. And this is the equation for the temperature, which includes that temperature gradient. So for stably stratified flows, this will be negative, dT by dz. So the whole thing becomes negative. And for RBC, it is positive. Okay, so there are a few parameters, which again, for people who are not familiar with this field, the Prandtl number is nu by kappa, which is viscosity by thermal diffusivity, and Rayleigh number, which is buoyancy by nonlinear, buoyancy by viscosity, sorry, buoyancy by viscous effects. Now, I think we'll ignore this. I will just explain what they mean at later time, but we don't need to get into that, those parameters. So stably stratified flows, there are several regimes. So we focus on the third regime, which is isotropic regime, because we are looking for Kolmogorov-like spectrum or deviations. So we need to assume isotropy, which is not the case when gravity is too strong. So most of the simulation done for stably stratified flows were focused on this quasi-2D regime. Like Lindbergh, there was a talk in the morning. Strong gravity will make it quasi-2D, and what we are going to discuss in this talk will not work. So we are working on isotropic regime, approximately isotropic regime, that requires that Richardson number must be order one. We need to be careful about this. So there's one slide I would like to flash, because this is the important slide. So let's look at the energetics of Kolmogorov flux. So we are in the Fourier space. So these are two spheres, one black sphere and a blue sphere. And this pi k is the flux coming out of the black sphere, and pi k plus dk is the flux coming from blue sphere. Now, Kolmogorov assumes this flux to be constant, equal. The reason being there's no forcing in this region, and there's no dissipation. In fact, related to your talk yesterday. So, but what happens if there's a forcing? If there's forcing, then the flux can change. Also, if there's a dissipation is strong, then the flux can change. And we get very simple energetics argument that d pi by dk will be flux, supplied by the external forcing, Fk, minus dk. Now, these are relevant for buoyancy-driven flows, Fk, because buoyancy will act at all scales. And we'd like to see what are the effects of this. Now, just a simple analysis that if Fk is less than zero and ignore dk, let's ignore this. So basically, I take the energy out. The forcing is such a way that it takes the kinetic energy out. So flux will decrease with k. So this will decrease with k. It won't be Kolmogorov-like. It will decrease with k. What if the forcing feeds energy? Then flux should increase with k. So these are, in fact, these will be the key for these two systems, stably stratified flows and Rayleigh-Bernard. So in fact, let me just tell you beforehand, this will be stably stratified flows. So flux will decrease with k. And this will be Rayleigh-Bernard, where flux will increase with k. So this one important point, that this is independent of isotropy assumption. I didn't assume any isotropy, because this is an energetic argument. And we work with Fourier space, which basically has multi-scale built-in. So this I had interesting conversation with Shelley, and so this is connected with one paper he has written in 1999. So there's a famous theory by Bolgiano and Nabokov in 1959 for stably stratified flows. It wasn't for relay Bernard, it was for stably stratified flows. So this is a flux plot. So as I said, I focus on flux. So what happens to the flux, kinetic energy flux? It will decrease with K. Why? Because kinetic energy gets converted to potential energy, then to dissipation. Because it's a stable system, kinetic energy is lost to potential. And the flux will decrease with K. So this is decreasing with K. And this is the loss of kinetic energy. So the example which I like to give is, if there's energy supply from the federal government and money supply, not energy supply, and keeps going down to a smaller and smaller scale to grassroots level, if there's no corruption, then the money should be same. But if there's a corruption, then money coming at the bottom will be less. And this happens for stably stratified flows. Okay? So as a result, in fact, this is a crux of the Bolgiano-Nabokov argument. The flux is decreasing with K. This is nonlinear with equating the terms and it's simple analysis. Flux is decreasing with K, K minus 4 by 5, and spectrum is minus 11 by 5. It is not phi third. And so let's focus only on this regime. I will not discuss about some other subtle points, but we'll ignore that. Okay, now, some earlier work I will again skip, but as I said, most of the work focused on strong gravity, which was not looking at this regime. We had to be careful in looking for isotropic regime. So there's a lot of work by Lindbergh, which was discussed today morning talk. So let's see whether this Bolgiano-Nabokov theory is correct or not. It's a scaling argument, may work, may not work. So we looked at this by spectral simulation. So these are the plots for kinetic energy normalized. So the two normalization is above is 11 by 5 and bottom is 5/3. So 11 by 5 is better, not very great, but it's better. It's 1,000 cube simulation, not the largest one, but it is. That's what we got. And these are the theta, basically temperature or density spectrum. This is flatter, 7 by 5. So it's also a prediction of Bolgiano-Nabokov that it will be 7 by 5. K is minus 7 by 5, okay? So let's look at this one. This is a dissipation, and that is the forcing. FK is the forcing. Supply by the force. So FK is negative, that means kinetic energy is getting converted to potential. There's loss of kinetic energy, okay? So they're all consistent in Bolgiano-Nabokov. From various angles, we would say that it works. It is satisfactory. Now, let's look at, let's look at RBC. That is the main topic. So there's lots of work. RBC is a difficult problem, which, everybody would say that yes, what is the spectrum? So I will not again discuss this, but one major point is that experiments are difficult because the Taylor hypothesis does not work. So how do I deduce the spectrum from the experiment? Because there's no mean flow, I cannot resort to Taylor hypothesis. So there has been a lot of confusion, what is the spectrum? So let's look at the energetics argument again and see whether we can resort, we can get some solution, we can get some answer. Now there is a work by, field theory work by Prokashia, Jatak, Lavov, and they kind of claimed that it's the same equation actually, equation is the same for Relay-Bernard as well as for stably stratified flows, then Bolgiano-Nabokov theory should work. The spectrum must be minus 11 by 5. But there's a problem in the argument, that this energetics argument is not correct. There's one place where the FK, the sign of FK is different. Okay, so let's look at in detail. So this is what I showed this picture before. What should be the FK for Relay-Bernard? Remember it was negative for stably stratified flows because there was a conversion from kinetic to potential. Stable system, kinetic energy is lost to potential. But in Relay-Bernard, quite clearly, the plumes feed energy to kinetic. So the FK must be positive. FK cannot be negative for relevant energy. We know that thermal energy, the temperature feeds kinetic energy. We start with, just start, take a normal fluid, start heating, it convection starts. So FK has a different sign for relevant energy than established liquid flows. So the whole phenomenology is not going to work. Bolyai-Unubakov does not work for relevant energy. That's a simple argument from energetics. So this is a picture. Earlier, you recall that the flux was decreasing with K, but here the flux is not decreasing, but it should increase with K because thermal plumes are feeding energy to kinetics. And then it should kind of flatten because maybe the buoyancy becomes weak at small scales and it should flatten. So we were looking for this kind of flux profile. And what happens to the spectrum? Spectrum should become shallower because the flux is increasing. So spectrum should become not 5, well, basically minus 1.5 or so. It should not be steeper, but it should be shallower than 5/3 in this regime, but 5/3 here. So we started doing the simulation. In fact, we did a very big simulation. This 4,000 cube simulation with our code Tarang, it's a machine in Kaust, Sahin 2. We reached Rayleigh number quite large. In spectral, this is the highest, 10 per 11. So I will show you what we get. It is there a bit of surprise. So I'm expecting something shallower than 5/3, not Bolyai-Unubakov. So we find this is a spectrum for 4,000 cube. It is kind of two decayed 5/3. This is 5/3 scale, normalized to 5/3. And the flux is very flat, constant. So I'm not getting increase of the flux. I was expecting the flux to increase because buoyancy is feeding energy to kinetic. And it's quite clean 5/3. There is we have some other model, but I'll skip that part. So this is, details are there in a 2014 paper of ours, and 2016 there's a review article, New Journal of Physics, which you'll get more details. But now the question comes, why is flux not increasing? Now we are in a kind of dilemma. The flux does not increase for another subtle reason. So we looked at all the terms of momentum equation or the velocity equation. We find that buoyancy is, this is a buoyancy term. So these are magnitudes. The arrows are magnitudes of various terms of momentum equation. It turns out the pressure gradient is much bigger than the buoyancy term, several times bigger. So buoyancy, even though they're active, they're thermal plumes, they're not very large. So it is feeding energy, but it is not the most significant term. It's a pressure gradient which is driving the flow, and that is why Rayleigh-Bernard has very strong similarity with hydroturbulence, 3D. So that is why we are getting 5/3. In fact, the Kolmogorov constant for Rayleigh-Bernard is very close to hydro, 1.8 or so we got. In simulation, that's what we get. So this was kind of work by my another student, Ambrish Pandey, and we could show this connection that pressure gradient is the most dominant. In fact, it was very, very surprising for us. I mean, why should pressure gradient be the most dominant term? But it is for Rayleigh-Bernard. It is, buoyancy is weak compared to pressure gradient. So it is basically hydro. Now I'll show you some more evidences why we are getting that. Now before that, I'd like to say about temperature spectrum in Rayleigh-Bernard. Now, we don't get a single spectrum, but we get dual lines. There are two lines. So this is E theta, temperature fluctuation. The top line and bottom line. Now, this again, I mean, why should we get these lines? And they're not numerical artifacts. It turns out the top line is 1 over k squared, and this line is fluctuation. Now, the reason why 1 over k squared is coming is because of these walls. So there's a boundary layer, so the temperature drops flat, then drops again. And if I look at theta, which is the fluctuation, it has a linear growth, okay? Now these are a bit of mathematics, it's easy to get. So this is the total temperature, but theta has this growth. And if I do the Fourier transform, I get this. And so the Fourier transform of the large scale average temperature is this. This is, and if I square this, I get 1 over k squared. Now, I believe it should be also show up in pipe flow or so. The mean flow has a signature in the fluctuation. Now, I don't know how, but here we really get this feature in all our simulations. Now, let's look at why Kolmogorov spectrum, we'll revisit. So one argument I said is the pressure gradient is the most dominant one, even for Rayleigh Bernard. Let's look at anisotropy. Is the flow strongly anisotropic? Now, these are the numbers, E per by 2E parallel. So we look at E per by 2E parallel, this anisotropy parameter. For isotropy, it is 1. But these for different Prandtl numbers. These are runs for different Prandtl numbers. We get numbers from 0.63 to 0.3. And for Prandtl number 1, it is the least anisotropic or most isotropic. 0.73 is close to 1. So the flow is not strongly anisotropic, even though there are plumes. But they basically, if you look at statistically, they are close to isotropic. That's one signature which comes from here. These are a free slip, but for no slip as well, we get very similar results. Now, these are called ring spectrum, which is a good measure of anisotropy. So this is angular, so we just do for different angles. We look at the EK, and it looks, except this region where there's some small stretching up, it is isotropic. So these for Rayleigh Bernard, Rayleigh 10^8, Prandtl number 1. So it's, I mean, if I did fluid turbulence, other than, if I didn't look at this region, I would say this like hydro, no issues. Let's look at shell-to-shell spectrum. Sorry, not shell-to-shell spectrum. Shell-to-shell energy transfers. It's supposed to be local for hydro. Now let's look at what happens for RBC. Is it local? Local and forward. Now the picture is, this is a picture for, so now if you're not used to this figure, so giver shells are here and receiver shells are below. So shell 10, the diagonal will be here. 10 to 10 is 0. 10 cannot give to itself. But 10 to 11 is positive. Red is positive. It's positive. And 10 to 9 is negative. So it's, and it's basically banded. That means the most energy goes from N to N plus 1. And it's very, very similar to hydrodynamic turbulence. So Rayleigh Bernard and hydro are very, very close. They're not very different. Okay, now quickly, how much time I got? 10 minutes or 10 minutes, okay. So real space probes, now since there's no mean flow, especially if you do experiment in cylinder, then how do I apply, how do I get spectrum? Now most experiments, there are few PIVs, but mostly it is temperature measurements near the edge. So these are, we are doing for a cube, some simulations. So there will be probes at various phases. You know? And we look at velocity or temperature, mostly temperature. And from that, we extrapolate to velocity. Now, so we look at the frequency spectrum and relate it to EK, Fourier spectrum. Now, if there's no Taylor hypothesis, because there's no mean flow like in that one direction, like wind tunnel, your EK is suspect because EF, we cannot extrapolate to EK. So we try to see this in a cube, not in a cylinder actually. Cylinder, of course, our code does not work for cylinder. But cylinder, Srini has done a lot of experiments and also there are other people, Gunter Ehlers. So it turns out the mean flow rotates in cylinder, azimuthally. But in a cube, for our Rayleigh number, the mean flow does not reverse. It just goes on and on along a diagonal. So that can be treated as a mean flow for applying Taylor hypothesis. And then look for spectrum. So that's what my student Abhishek, again, he did a lot of this simulations. These are no slip boundary condition with open foam. Temperature, velocity, vertical velocity field at one of the probes, it is positive, fluctuating. And opposite diagonal, it will be negative. So this, in fact, there's a roll going around. In fact, you can see here, it's going down like this. So the spectrum, it is highly fluctuating. There's not a very high resolve simulation, high resolve simulation. So there's a 5/3 here. You may not believe me, but OK, I mean, we are claiming it is still 5/3. We are trying to do bigger simulation. But possibly EF and EK are 5/3 from the simulation. Now, There are works where you try to get spectrum in the middle. Put the probe in the middle of the box, and the spectrum is minus 2. It is not minus 5/3. And F minus 2 is purely because there's no mean flow. This, in Landau's book, there's no mean flow gives you F minus 2 spectrum. Now, can we relate it to other systems? Now, this argument, energetics argument, I really like it. It is very general. So it should also work for Rayleigh-Taylor. Because it's a gravity-driven flow, Rayleigh-Taylor is unstable, so the same argument should work. Why should, I mean, it's quite obvious that it's unstable. And similar energetics, so gravity is feeding energy to kinetic energy, so 5/3 should work. And there are papers, I mean, a lot of work by Buffetta's work, Stefano. In 3D, there are claims that it is minus 5/3. There are some papers. Of course, there will be papers which will say minus 11/5. So, but I think we should also kind of trust some energetics or some theoretical arguments. And I am a strong believer that RTIs in 3D should give minus 5/3. Bubbly turbulence is again Poincaré driven. Bubbles are shaking the fluid up. It should again be minus 5/3. These are some conjectures from this theory, and I hope it works. Unstable stratification, like salt water above pure water, this should again be minus 5/3. So stable stratification is 11/5, but Rayleigh-Bernard is, or unstable stratification should be minus 5/3. Now, what about 2D RBC, our boundary layer? So this part is not clear to us right now. 2D RBC, I can make some, again, similar energetic arguments. So, two dimensions RBC, there's inverse cascade. I think a lot of people see that, there's inverse cascade, and it's natural, there will be inverse cascade. So if I look at these two regions, A and B, in the case, again, this is a wave number, so which should be bigger, A or B? So if I feed energy, then energy is coming to large scale, so small k, so pi A must be bigger than pi B. So, because I'm feeding energy in the middle, so it will be bigger. Unlike, so this 3D and 2D will have different RBC behavior. So pi k bigger, and the flux decreases with k. Modulus, mod flux. So we expect 2D could have some signature of Bolyai-Nabokov in RBC. And I kind of conjecture that maybe the boundary layer, if I take a section, that could, turbulent boundary layer could show minus 11/5, not 5/3. So there could be difference between bulk and the boundary layer spectrum. We don't know. I mean, that part is not very clear at the moment. OK, so I conclude. So stably stratified flows for Freud number or Richardson order one, we get Bolyai-Nabokov. So Bolyai-Nabokov is, the argument is quite nice, correct, it works. We could verify it through simulation. So this part I'll skip, I didn't really say this. I didn't show it. So in fact, if our gravity is weak, then we get Kolmogorov. So this. Now for Rayleigh-Bernard, Kolmogorov scaling in three dimensions, and the pressure gradient is much bigger than buoyancy. So there are a lot of signatures why hydrodynamic turbulence and Rayleigh-Bernard have a lot of similarities. And boundary layers is a different physics which we are not very confident what would happen there. And I stop here. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.